We start our next session, and will be presented by Anna Laura Jans.
Is it kind of guy? Perfect.
So, please.
Okay, thank you for listening to me at least. So, I'm Anne Lorbiance. I come from the Institut Lumière-Matière. Institute of Light of Matter is a physics lab in Lyon. Lyon in the middle of France, I would say. And this is a work jointly performed mostly by a PhD student, Yedir Mezach, who defended, I think, 2 years ago, with some colleagues from Institut Lumière-Matière, François Détchevéry and Marie Lemerer. And also with people from LMFI, the Fluid Mechanics Lab in Lyon also, Peter Spelt, who passed away, but who designed the code that we used in this work, and Bastien Di Piero, which is also a colleague on numerical simulation in LMFI. So the idea is to understand surfactant-induced dissipation in sheared foam. And so why do we study liquid foam? It's because it's encountered in many, many applications in food engineering, firefighting, oil recovery, cosmetics, medical engineering also. It is used as contrast agent, for example, for echography. Mineral flotation, which can be very useful, for example, if you want to create new batteries and so on. And also in building industry. So here it's an image of a concrete foam. So that people are using in the industry. And so it's a solid foam, but before making it, it is a liquid foam that is going to solidify. And it's very useful because it's acoustically and thermally insulating material. It's very light, very easy to transport, and so on. And I would say we are not the first to use foams and solid foam as in the building industry. So I don't know if you can see the movie, but it's a Tongara frog. It's a frog from South America that is making also foam to put some eggs. So it's a foam nest. And with their saliva, they put a kind of surface active agent. With their legs, they are making the foam. And it's going to solidify at some point. And it's a thermally and a light insulating material where they can put their eggs safely. So why is it important and interesting to study foam rheology, and why is it complicated? Because the foam is a multi-scale material. So you can look at it as a complex material at the scale of, 10 centimeters, I would say, when you have a shaving foam, for example. And you can look at it also at a local scale, a few bubbles. So here is a skeleton of a foam, I would say. So you have soap film, which are separated like cells, I would say, air cells. And these soap film are connected from one to the other by this kind of small channels, which are called plateau borders. Plateau is due to the Belgian physicist Joseph Plateau, who designed the geometry of this connection between the soap film. You can also look at a foam at a nanoscale, I would say, at the scale of the thickness of the film, around 10 nanometers if they are at equilibrium, or 1 micrometer if they are set by dynamic, considerations. And you can also have it, look at it at the nanometer scale, the scale of surfactants. Indeed, a foam is like an assembly of gas bubbles in a surfactant solution. And the surfactant nature is very important. And when you see that, you see the challenge in a numerical computation to bridge these scales and to understand what are the important physical ingredients to consider foam rheology. And for example, in experiment, it was shown that if you change the nature of the surfactant that you use, the rheological behavior is fundamentally different. So for example, I report here the viscous stress as a function of the shear rate. So it's dimensionless quantities. It spans over many decades. And you can see that if you just change the surfactant nature, this is some experiment performed in the group of Nikolai Denkov, I would say 15 years ago. So just now, Nikolai Denkov is the prime minister of Bulgaria, so he's not doing experiments anymore, I would say. But if you change the surfactant nature, you can change fundamentally the rheology, and you even change the scaling law here. And okay, what is the link between this and this rheology? And this is what we try to understand in the lab, I would say. So we focus on an intermediate scale, which is the bubble scale. And what is going on when you shear a foam at the bubble scale? You have so-called topological rearrangements. So here you can see two bubble layers. you imagine that the top layer is moving in this direction, the bottom layer is moving in the reverse direction, and what you observe is that the two bubbles 1 and 4, at the beginning they are far away, and at some point they are going to be neighbors, and the liquid film between 2 and 3 is going to collapse, and a new film, new subfilm is going to be created between the bubbles 1 and 4. So the time scale of this relaxation, of the creation of this new film between 1 and 4, has been experimentally measured. And you can see also that it spans over three orders of magnitude, like between 1 millisecond to 1 second for millimetric bubbles, I would say. And so it depends a lot, in fact, on the surfactant nature. And from a mechanical point of view, we show that it was really correlated to what we call the surface viscosity. So this has to be defined, divided by the surface tension, and this is a characteristic time scale, I would say, of the dynamic of this T1 iron wheels. It was also shown in other experiments in wet foam this time, so foam with a lot of liquid, I would say. So it's the bottom of your foam, shaving foam, or at the end of your bottle, I would say, that it was also dependent on the liquid viscosity. So you have a balance between interfacial properties and bulk properties like the liquid viscosity. And in the lab, we made experiments now a few years ago where we looked at this rearrangement in this kind of geometry. So we have a kind of cubic frame here that we plunge in a surfactant solution. You have this kind of soapy architecture. And if you change here the aspect ratio, you go from this film, which is going to collapse, to create just one vertices, and a new film is going to be created. What is nice is that this film is planar. You can have optical access. You can look at the flow pattern, the thickness of the film. And if we do that, we show that we have two regimes, depending on the nature of surfactant. A regime for the film creation, which is called the pooling regime, where the liquid is exchanged between the film here and the plateau border, the connectors between the film here. And this regime is dominated by viscous dissipation. We also have just a stretching regime where you just have an elongation of the film. And here, the dissipation is driven by surface dissipation. And you can compare both and build a dimensionless number, which is called the Boussinesque number, I would say. And you have the pooling regime, which dominates over the stretching regime. If this number is larger than one, I would say that the system is going to choose the less dissipative pathway to relax. OK, but here I introduced surface viscosity, or interfacial dissipation, I would say. But how does it link to the microscopic properties of the surfactants? How can I say, OK, if I use this surfactant, this will be this mu s. If I use this type of surfactant, this will be another mu s, or whatever. And this is what we are trying to define here. And this is the content of what I'm going to talk about. I will show you some numerical simulations that we perform on this topic. I will present you a simple linear model that we have, and I will try to make some comparison between both. So the numerical simulation, it's a level set simulation, so it's a code designed by Peter Spelt, as I mentioned, to track the interface, and the idea is to be in a kind of wet foam. You have a spherical, hemispherical bubble, which are pinned here to two plates, so you make a shear between these two plates, you have gas, you have liquid, and you look at the system evolve. Okay, why do we need to have wet foam? It's because if the film here is too thin, we will have numerical coalescence. We don't have any repulsion forces between the two interfaces here. That's a lacking ingredient, and we'll be happy to have this ingredient. So the inputs of the simulation are very classical. We have Navier-Stokes equation, of course, for incompressible flow. We have interfacial stress, so we have a jump stress at the interface. A normal jump stress is due to Laplace pressure, and the tangential stress induces Marangoni stresses, I would say. We have advection diffusion equation for the surfactants in the bulk and at the interface. No surfactants in here. And we also put some exchange rate between the bulk and the interfaces for the surfactants. So we add an absorption and desorption rate in this dynamic here. The output of the simulation is as usual. We have the bubble shape and the velocity field. We can compute the bulk surfactant concentration profile that I'm going to note capital F, and the surface concentration profile, which will be small f. Okay, I just put the equation here. It's so in a level set, it's a single fluid equations. So you have incompressible Navier-Stokes here with the Laplace stress and the Marangoni stress. You have advection diffusion in the bulk and at the interface with the exchanging here. And you have a law for the surfactant exchanges with an absorption rate and a desorption rate, which are linked by equilibrium properties. So how does it go? So we take a minimal cell, which is half of the cell that I presented on the left here. Here we saw the simulation. The gray level corresponds to the bulk concentration. So when it's black, you don't have surfactant. When it's white, you have a lot of surfactants. And here the color scale corresponds to the surface concentration of surfactants. So when it's blue, you have depletion of surfactants. And when it's red, you have a lot of surfactants. So I show you the simulation.
Okay.
And you can see that you have some zones of depletion or accumulation of surfactants during the bubble shear in the simulation. Okay, so here you have a lot of surfactant accumulation, and here some surfactant depletion. And you can see that it's correlated between the interface and the bulk. Okay, so what are the relevant dimensionless numbers, and how can we link this number with the surfactant properties? So of course, the relevant dimensionless number are the bulk Becquerel number, which compare advection and diffusion of surfactants. So we say, for example, if we have a big surfactant, the diffusion coefficient will be small, and then we will have a small, large Becquerel number. We also have a surface Becquerel number that we are going to neglect in the simulation. It will be set to 1,000, so we have no diffusion at the interface. We also have a Biot number, which corresponds to exchange. So it's desorption rate here versus advection in the system. So large Biot numbers correspond to fast exchanges between the interface and the bulk. And also, we have this very important parameter, which is called an absorption length, which compare, in fact, the number of surfactants we have at the interface with the number of surfactants we have in the bulk. So it's very sensitive to the size of the film or the size of the domain, meaning that if this number is very large, you don't have enough surfactant in the bulk to replenish the interface. So you have finite reservoir effects, which are very important to consider here. And then you cannot have equilibrium in this case. So I show you some results from the simulation. We can have flow pattern, and then we can compute, for example, the local dissipation. And this is what we obtain, for example, for a small Becquerel number and a large Becquerel number. And we can see that the viscous dissipation is very different. Here, you have more dissipation. Here, it much more looks like an elongation flow, I would say. And here, it looks like much more like a shear flow. So we can look at the local dissipation. This is, I would say, interesting. But this is not what we would like to investigate. We want to understand the origin of surface dissipation. And for that, what we can see is if we compute the injected power from the work due to the wall motion, I would say, this is in blue, and the viscous dissipation, we can see that it's oscillating when the bubbles are switching from one to the other, but there is a difference between the two quantities, and the difference between the two quantities is due to surface dissipation, or surface work. So you can compute it whether by making this difference, or you can show it's compatible with the work at interfaces, which will be the integral on all the interfaces of the surface tension multiplied by the surface divergence of the velocity. So this is average over one oscillation. So how to feel how it works with the end? I would say end. The idea is you have an interface with a lot of surfactants in the bulk and at the interface. You're going to stretch the interface, so it will have a mechanical cost. The cost will be gamma multiplied by ds, and the surface tension will be large because you will have less surfactant at the interface. I would say after some time, the surfactants are going to absorb again on the interface, and when you come back, you recover some elastic energy, but you recover less energy because here the surface tension will be lower because you have the time of the surfactants that they come here. So you have more surfactants, smaller surface tension. And so when you do this kind of cycles, you can see that you have some loss and some then dissipation. So here I report the dissipation that we obtained from the numerical simulation for different parameters as a function of the absorption lens. So here, no finite reservoir effect, and here we have a lot of finite reservoir effects. What we observe is that at slow h, we have a saturation here of the dissipation that depends on the Biot number, so that depends on the exchange rate. And for example, if we have a large exchange, we have a small dissipation, and if we have a smaller exchange, we have a higher dissipation. And sometimes we have a maximum. And so we wanted to understand the origins of this dissipation. And for that, we switch from this mechanical point of view to a thermodynamical point of view, which is not so much seen in the literature so far. So we came back to statistical physics, and we read the De Groot and Mazur. And the idea is the dissipation, or the rate of entropy creation, is equal to the flux multiplied by the thermodynamic force. So how does it work in our system with surfactants? So in our simulation, we have concentration gradients. So we have a diffusive flux. And in between, when we have concentration surfactant gradients, we have different chemical potentials that depend on the concentration of surfactant at some point. And then we have a dissipation which will be proportional to the diffusive flux multiplied by the gradient of chemical potential locally. So you can calculate this, and you find that if you are near equilibrium, that the dissipation due to diffusion will be proportional to the coefficient of diffusion of the surfactant multiplied by the gradient of concentration to the power 2. You can do the same for absorption-desorption. And in this case, the dissipation due to exchange will be proportional to the exchange rate, the flux here, J, multiplied by the difference of chemical potential when a surfactant is at the interface and in the bulk. So I put U before the chemical potential of the surfactant in the bulk. It was proportional to log the concentration of surfactant. And here at the interface, you have some kind of exclusion effect here. And you can then compute this formula. And you recover something near equilibrium again. The dissipation due to exchanges locally will be proportional to the flux of exchanges to the power 2 divided by the desorption rate. So if you do that, you can integrate this over the full domain. And what do we obtain? So here I put you the simulation again. So you can see, for example, the bulk concentration of surfactant, and you have some gradients, and then you will have diffusive flux, and then you will have dissipation due to that. And with the formula I showed you before, we can do some dissipation maps. And we can see the dissipation at interfaces here, or due to exchanges, I would say, and dissipation due to diffusion in the bulk. And you can look at the relative magnitude between both. What is the most important parameters depending on the Biot or the Peclet number in our system? So this is what we put here. This is the ratio between the dissipation due to diffusion and the dissipation due to exchanges. And we can see, for example, for intermediate or small h here, that we are here in an exchange-dominated regime. Indeed, we have a small Peclet number, so a large diffusion coefficient. So it corresponds to this case. And then we can go to a diffusion-dominated regime with a larger Peclet number. So we have much more concentration gradient. And then we can switch here on the switch to also diffusion-dominated regime. And this is due here to the fact that we have finite reservoir effect and that the surfactant to absorb at the interface need to diffuse along the whole system because you don't have enough surfactant in the vicinity of the interface. So you can see that depending on Peclet, Biot, and H, you can go from one regime to the others. And this is what we want to understand. And for that, we went to a simple linear model. So what do I mean by a simple linear model? So we revisited, in fact, the model, very old model of Lucassen and Van der Tempel, who just considered surfactant diffusion near the interface when you have a periodic oscillation of the interface. So the idea is to consider here a plane with surfactant. You have an infinite reservoir, and you made some oscillating variation of this interface, and this created some mechanical work. So if the surface tension is constant, if you have no diffusion or absorption of surfactant, you will have just an elastic response, but you also have a loss response due to very fast absorption of surfactant here and diffusion of surfactant here. And then you can calculate the surfactant concentration profile everywhere. It's analytical, it's a 1D model, and the mechanical work of the interface. So Lucassen, he did that, and he considered an infinite reservoir, instantaneous exchange at the interface, and just the surfactant motion diffusion limited. What we did is we extended this model with many complications, I would say, or many... We just considered that the exchange at the interface was not instantaneous. We have a desorption and absorption rate, so a Biot number. We add also some finite reservoir effect by putting two interfaces here with a certain width. So we kept, of course, the diffusion. And also we consider two cases, the symmetric cases, where the two interfaces here and here are in phase, so we stretch them and we compress them together. And also the asymmetric or antisymmetric cases, where, the, for example, the interface on the top is extended and compressed on the bottom. Why did we consider these two cases? It's because when we looked at the simulation, indeed here we have two interfaces which seems to be compressed and extended, compressed and extended in phase. But if you look here, it seems to be an opposition of phase. So I think it was important to have both contribution rates. And if you look, so I didn't put the analytical formula, but this is the results, I would say, for some range of parameters. And we recover, in fact, some features that we had in the simulation. So we have this kind of curve for the dissipation, which is shown here as a function of the absorption length, as before, for different dimensionless numbers in the symmetric and antisymmetric cases. And we can see that at small h, we still have a saturation, which depends again only on the Biot number, so Biot equal 10 here, 1 here. And we have sometimes the maximum, which differs if you are in the symmetric and antisymmetric case. And you have a decay at large absorption length and when you don't have any more reservoir. So you can compute this, you can calculate, and this is what we recover indeed. For example, at low H, the plateau is given by this simple formula. It indeed depends only on the Biot number. At large H, you can also compute the decay, and you find that it varies like 1 over H. And if you go to large Pecle, it varies like 1 of the square root of Pecle. The existence of the maximum is interesting because this is like a maximum of dissipation that we can recover. Where is this maximum located? And what does it physically mean? So this is some kind of map of this maximum. So here I report, in fact, the Pecle H, and this is a color bar for the dissipation. And what you can see is that the symmetric case, so if you are at low bio, you don't have a maximum, but if you have at larger bio and large Pecle, you have a maximum here, which is predicted analytically. And if you are in the antisymmetric case, you have two maxima, one at large Pecle and one at low Pecle. And at low Pecle, it's given by the dashed line here. And so physically, the location of the maximum, what does it correspond to? And if you consider at high Pecle, so in the symmetric and antisymmetric cases both, the location of the maximum is given when the absorption length is equal to 1 of the square root of Pecle. And it means physically that you have the diffusion boundary layer, which is equal to this absorption length. So you have a maximum of dissipation, in fact, when the diffusion boundary layer is equal to the amount of surfactants that you can have in the system. If you're at small Pecle, so you just have the maximum in the antisymmetric case, it means that the two interfaces can speak one to the other. For example, here you compress, so you will release some surfactants. They might have time to replenish here for this maximum. And then the maximum is given by a geometrical average between W and the absorption length. So the diffusive boundary layer is a geometrical average of W and absorption length. You can have a so finite reservoir effect and also communication between the two interfaces. Okay, so for the comparison, I show you here the result, dimensionless dissipation in the numerical simulation and in our simple Lucassen, extended Lucassen model. And we can see that we have a good qualitative agreement. We were quite satisfied with that. But I would say that this agreement is very sensitive to the parameter match. For example, in our simulation, what do we take for H? So in the Peclet number, in the Biot number, we need to put a length scale, and we put as a length scale the half of the width of the cell, but is it reasonable? And it depends a lot of this choice. For omega, the solicitation, we just take the frequency of T1, so this was much more easy to match. But for H, it brings many questions. What is the size of the film? On which scale is it going to diffuse? And so on. Last but not least, we wanted to try analytically to know the difference between dissipation by diffusion and exchange. So if you put it analytically, you can see that in the extended Lucassen model, it depends on the damped color number multiplied by a function of Peclet. But hopefully, in our parameter range, is so damped color number compares reaction and diffusion. It's a very common number in a system. And in our simulation, this function of Peclet is always close to 1. We are always in this plateau here. And so does it match our simulation, this prediction? I would say yes. So here is the difference of dissipation in ratio of dissipation by diffusion and exchanges as a function of H. And if you plot it as a function of the damped color number, you have a good collapse of all the curves. And the dashed line here is a, so this is a log-log plot, and this has a slope of 1. So it fits well our simple linear model. So as a conclusion, we did some simulation of dissipation in 2D bubble clusters. We performed extended Lucassen modeling, so linearized analytical approach. And we used a thermodynamic approach to compare both results. And then we were able to decipher the origin of surfactant dissipation in these clusters. Does it come from exchange or diffusion, depending on the properties of the system? As some outlook, we would like to go towards realistic system. And so far, we would like to go to 3D or more realistic parametric range. No contact light pinning. So far, I told you that the contact light were pinned to the plane, but we can do some shear without contact light pinning. We would like to go to dry foam and to induce a disjoining pressure, at least repulsion between the interface. And maybe to make a super extended Lucassen models with flows to account for viscous dissipation. And on this, I would like to thank you and to thank my colleagues.
Any questions, please?
Have 2 minutes. We have 2 minutes. Any questions? Yes.
I've got a quick question. Could you just say again what the origin of that maximum was? I mean, is it simple, or is it just it came out of the model? And
so it came out of the model, and physically it corresponds that how could I say that? So we don't have always the maximum. Okay.
Yeah.
But here, you have a finite reservoir effect, mm-hmm. So you need a lot of diffusion, and so you will add you will have a lot of dissipation due to this diffusion. And here, the dissipation is much more set by absorption, I would say. Mm-hmm. And in between, you have a maximum you have to add both contributions at some point.
Right, okay, yeah. So there's somehow some sort of lag in the exchange.
Yeah,
they're not exchanging at the same
trade
time.
Trade-off between diffusion okay. and exchange effect.
Thank you.
Any other? Yep.
So, hello, excellent work, really interesting. So, one question. Instead of dissipation, why is there a reason for not taking a more mechanistic approach in which you can see that the different surface concentration of surfactant at the bubbles induce a Marangoni stress that increases in the gap between the two bubbles, increases the shear rate, and then to measure in this way the force that you are exerting on the upper plate by simply integrating the shear stresses in the liquid, because through the Marangoni stresses you are increasing, and then there is you have the combination of the viscous dissipation plus the indirect effect in the liquid of the Marangoni stresses.
We would love to do that. I would say we look at first the mechanical approach. That's what we compute. It was fitting with the thermodynamical approach, so we were safe. But I agree that the main mechanism is viscous dissipation that I didn't consider so far. yes, we would love to do that, to see which Marangoni stress do we have and what are the consequences on the shear flow, of course. But it's not so easy. If you want to do some analytical modeling, you have to induce some flow in this Lucassen model, and then one dimension and so on and so on. And it's not so easy to make an analytical reaction.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, and once again.